I welcome all of you to my lecture sessions on natural chemistry for pharmacy and science students. So here I am initiating a new series of lectures on chemistry of terpenes. In today's session, we will discuss in detail about camphor and its chemistry. Camphor is a very widely used chemical as far as its medical as well as non-medical applications are concerned. So let's go ahead and see what is there in chemistry of camphor. Camphor is actually isolated from parts of camphor tree, that is Cinnamomum camphora. So this is the tree. Every part of this tree is surprisingly, it smells like camphor. And camphor is an optically active substance. In nature, if an optically active substance is available from a plant, that is optically active secondary metabolite is produced by a plant, we usually get a single isomer, okay, single enantiomer. But here you will see both dextro and levo isomers staying together. Okay, it is isolated as a racemic mixture. It is a solid having melting point 180 degrees centigrade, and it sublimes at room temperature, means its vapor pressure is less. So if you keep it in a corner of a room, it will evaporate without being converting to liquid. This compound is actually obtained by steam distillation of wood, leaves or bark of camphor tree. So these are the three parts majorly used for commercial production of camphor. It is used in pharmaceutical preparations, especially Ayurvedic preparations, because of its analgesic property and cardiac muscle stimulant property, expectorant activity, as well as antiseptic properties. So apart from pharmaceutical applications, it is used extensively in the manufacture of celluloid films, the films that are used for making movies, and smokeless powder and explosives. It's a very important constituent of making explosives. It is also used as moth repellent. So I didn't mention one thing over here, because camphor is one very important ingredient in the religious practices in our country. So in the chemistry part, chemistry of any unknown compound, okay, so first thing that we do is obtain its molecular formula. So here the molecular formula of camphor is C10H16O. So let's calculate the number of unsaturation, degrees of unsaturations. So number of carbons minus number of hydrogens by 2 plus number of nitrogens by 2 plus 1. So this is the formula. So total 10 minus 8 plus 1, 3. So 3 unsaturations means what? 3 double bonds or 3 rings or a combination of both. Since we have here oxygen is also there, so this can be a part of functional groups, like it can be C double bond O or ether or OH. So this is the information that we can derive from molecular formula. Okay, so this is a 3 degrees of unsaturation are there. So there is a possibility that you can have unsaturations in the compound like C double bond C, etc. Now we have to do chemical tests to verify whether these functional groups are there or not. Now, we will do classical chemical tests. Let's say if you take camphor and if you perform test for unsaturation. So what are the tests for unsaturations that we have? One is Bayer's test. Second one is bromine water test. Okay, so Bayer's reagent is cold dilute alkaline KMnO4 reagent and bromine water. If the substance, they found that camphor is not decolorizing both the reagents, hence the compound is saturated. So if the compound is saturated, how to account for the 3 degrees of unsaturations that we have? Definitely, the 3 unsaturations are because of rings. Okay, so this indicates that it has rings. Further, the compound was tested for all functional groups, but 2 reactions were found to be positive. They are, one is 2,4-DNP reagent, when you add it to the compound, then it has given hydrazone, crystalline compound, and hydroxylam and hydrochloride reacted with camphor to give oxime. So these are the two characteristic reactions to indicate presence of a carbonyl carbon. Then the compound was reduced with sodium amalgam to obtain secondary alcohol. So how can you get secondary alcohol from carbonyl carbon? Let's say if you have, what is the secondary alcohol? COH, when it is connected to two carbons. So this is what we call it as secondary alcohol. Okay, so this can be obtained after reduction of C double bond OC. So what is this compound? It's a ketone. Okay, so the compound is definitely a ketone compound. It's not an aldehyde. If you have an aldehyde group, you would have got a primary alcohol. Second one is, where exactly is this ketone? So when the compound was oxidized with nitric acid, they've got a dicarboxylic acid by name camphoric acid. Okay, so this is a dicarboxylic acid, and it has a molecular formula C10H16O3. It's a dicarboxylic acid. Okay, so this is the molecular formula of camphoric acid. Here you can clearly see that even after oxidative degradation, though the compound broke open into dicarboxylic acid, they did not see any change in carbon number. How it is possible? Let's say you take this case where oxidative degradation usually happens at a functional group. So let's say if you have this ketone like this, let's say you have this bond degraded, then what you will get? C double bond O OH and CO OH. Sorry, CO OH. Okay, so this is it. So let's say if those two compounds are a part of structure like this, then it will be degraded and then two entities are going to be separated. So if the separation is not possible, what is the what is the meaning? That means the two ends were connected. Okay, so in case of this also, if it is like this, okay, it's a cyclic ketone, then even if you break this bond over here via oxidative degradation, then you will see that both the carbons remain with the structure. Okay, so all these observations indicated that the compound is cyclic ketone. And if you merge these two observations and then see the big picture, because you have here a cyclic ketone and this accounts for one unsaturation. In the beginning we had calculated that there are three unsaturations are needed, so two more unsaturations we can account for only by considering a bicyclic compound, bicyclic structure in camphor. Okay, so I think I made myself clear here. So this is the way how camphor's preliminary structure framework was elucidated. Now we need to know the size of the bicycle. Okay, each ring, how big is the ring? So here one test which helped us is this one. So when the camphor was treated with zinc chloride or phosphorus pentoxide, P2O5, it has resulted, along with other degraded products, paracyamine. Okay, so here we have a benzene ring. So this indicated that one of the ring in camphor is actually a six-membered ring. So this is the ultimate observation. Okay, so one of the ring is six-membered ring. Further, the structure of camphor was elucidated via sequential degradation of camphor. So in the first step, camphor was degraded by using nitric acid to obtain camphoric acid, a dicarboxylic acid. So here if you see the molecular formula, C10H16O6. So if you calculate the number of unsaturations, 10 minus 8 plus 1 is equal to 3. It's a bicarboxylic acid. Dicarboxylic acid means two carboxylic acid units will be there. Means two unsaturations, because C double bond O is there, two unsaturations we can account for, it gives us one. Okay, So camphoric acid formed from camphor by opening ring opening reaction to result in one more two carboxylic acids and one ring remained over there. Further, the camphoric acid was oxidized again. Okay, so it resulted in another compound, camphoronic acid. It's a tricarboxylic acid, and its molecular formula is one carbon less than camphoric acid. Means with the loss of carbon, camphoronic acid was formed. So if you see the molecular formula here and then calculate number of unsaturations, 9 minus 7 plus 1. So how much it will be? 10 minus 7, 3. And here we have tricarboxylic acid, means 3 into C double bond OOH. So what does it mean? 3 unsaturations are accounted for here. So camphoronic acid is actually a saturated compound, and it's not a cyclic compound. Okay, it's an acyclic molecule. So in the beginning, we presumed that camphor should have two rings, where one of the ring is broken down, and then upon oxidative degradation, we got camphoric acid with one ring, and this ring also is degraded in the next oxidation by nitric acid to obtain camphoronic acid. So now we have to go ahead and piece the structural information together by reverse thinking. A structural elucidation of camphor was actually pursued in such a manner that they started first knowing structure of camphoronic acid. From there, they built the structure of camphoric acid, and then from there, camphor. So this is the way how they got the structure of camphor. First, let's see how camphoronic acid structure was elucidated. Camphoronic acid was first distilled at atmospheric pressure. Because it's a tricarboxylic acid, it can be subjected to destructive distillation. So this is what they have done. At atmospheric pressure, when they distilled camphoronic acid, they got four compounds. That is isobutyric acid, trimethyl succinic acid, carbon dioxide, and carbon. So these are the four components that are obtained. But if you see the structure of these constituents, if you count the number of carbons, here we have 4 and trimethyl succinic acid 7. If you add these two, okay, it is coming up to 11. But here we have molecular formula only C9. That means bisobutyric acid must be there in the trimethyl succinic acid also. If you closely observe the structure, see here we have it. Okay, so there is something that is getting degraded from this carbon. So we can grow the chain from here to obtain camphoronic acid. Further, scientists observed that camphoronic acid did not decarboxylate under ordinary condition. Usually, when you have a carboxylic acid structures like this, COOH, CH2COOH, if you have a structure like this, if you simply add acidic environment, if you maintain acidic environment and slightly warm it, then there is a possibility of removal of one of the carboxylic acid to give compounds like this. Okay, so this is one reaction we used to observe in organic chemistry laboratory. But this compound did not decarboxylate. Okay, so what does it mean? The carboxylic acids, all these carboxylic acids are present on different carbons. It is not like alpha dicarboxylic acid, okay? So here with this, scientists proposed this as the structure. So here you can clearly see all the carboxylic acids are present on different carbons, okay? So if you cut down the structure over here, it can result in carbon dioxide. Carboxylic acid will be degraded to carbon dioxide, and you have the component over here which can result in carbon formation, and the remaining unit is nothing but trimethyl succinic acid. Okay, and the second option is this one. If you cut it down over here, then you have a butyric acid over here, and if you remove this carboxylic acid, the remaining structure, so the unit over here, this is also isobutyric acid. Okay, so here also we have isobutyric acid, and here also we have isobutyric acid. So in this way, scientists proposed this structure, and then the structure elucidation happened via synthesis. The structure was confirmed by synthesis by Perkin Jr. and Thorpe. First, they have taken acetoacetate, ethyl acetoacetate, and then they performed alkylation reaction, because here if you see the structure of ethyl acetoacetate, the carbon over here is activated methylene. So there, okay, so by using strong alkaline agent, we can abstract a proton from over here so that a carbanion can be generated. Okay, so by using alkali, a carbanion can be generated like this, COOET. And then if you let it react with methyl iodide, methyl iodide will become CH3 plus I minus. Okay, carbocation is going to be generated. This carbocation is going to attack over this, and that way, in that way, methylation happens. If you do this reaction twice, okay, if you use 2 moles of methyl iodate, the reaction repeats for 2 times, so that dimethyl ethyl acetoacetate is going to be formed. 1, 2. 2, 2 dimethyl ethyl acetoacetate is going to be formed. So this is taken. So for your ease of understanding, I am redrawing it like this. Both are the same, okay. So I am redrawing it like that. So both are same, okay. Now, the carbonyl carbon over here is made to react with bromoethyl acetate. Okay, it's by using Reformatsky reaction, which is a very standard reaction to obtain this compound. Okay, so this part is added over here. It is like RMGX type of reaction, Grignard type of reaction. So if Reformatsky reaction happens across the C double bond, O, corresponding alcohol is going to be generated. Now what is it that we need to do? So if you compare the structure, both the structures, we have CH3 here, CH3 is there, COOET is there. What we need to have is over here, we need COOH group. So how to incorporate COOH group over here? So what is the equivalent of COOH group? CONH2. What is the equivalent of CONH2? CN. Cyanide upon hydrolysis, it can give us amide. Okay, amide upon hydrolysis can give us carboxylic acid. Okay, so this is the way how we think by using retrosynthetic strategy. So here what they have done is, first they have converted alcohol to chloride to facilitate nucleophilic substitution reaction, because alcohol is a very bad leaving group. So that's why it is converted to first chlorine, then chlorine will be replaced by cyanide. Okay, now we have here nitrile derivative. So cyanide upon hydrolysis, it will give us the target product. Okay, upon hydrolysis, it gives us the target product. So this is the way how the synthesized product and the product obtained after oxidative degradation both were found to be identical. So in this way, camphoronic acid structure is confirmed. So friends, I hope I made things clear for you. So let's move ahead onto structure of camphoric acid. So camphoric acid's molecular formula is C10H16O6. Okay, so this upon oxidation is giving us camphoronic acid. So this is camphoronic acid. So as we have seen in the beginning itself, because its molecular formula is C10H16O6, 10 minus 8 plus 1 is equal to 3. Okay, so 3 unsaturations are needed. Camphoric acid contains 2 carboxylic acids, so 2 unsaturations, if you minus, you remain with 1 unsaturation. So 1 unsaturation is because of a ring. So this is what we have seen earlier, okay, in the previous slide. Now, camphoronic acid is formed by losing one carbon. Okay, one carbon is lost to obtain camphoronic acid. So how can you build it back? So you have to convert this one to a substance with one ring and then add one carbon with functional group. So usually, because in case of oxidative degradation, when C-C bond is broken, it is broken as COOH and COOH, okay? So this is the way how the bonds are broken. Now here we have 1, 2, 3 carboxylic acids are there. So which carboxylic acid has to be fused onto which carboxylic acid is what we have to see right now. And then we have to add the carbon. Okay, so here in this fragment we have CH2COOH and here we have a COOH here. Okay, so here if you join these two carboxylic acids, 1, 2, 3, 4, so you are going to get cyclobutane, a structurally highly rigid and strained ring. And if you join these two carboxylic acids, then what is going to happen? 1, 2, 3, 4. Again, it also gives you cyclobutane. And if you join this carboxylic acid and this carboxylic acid, then you will get, okay, then you are going to get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, a 5-membered ring. So scientists preferred 5-membered ring because it is going to, because we also need to have one more 6-membered ring. So here what happened is, so this is the proposal. So they joined this carboxylic acid and this carboxylic acid to ultimately give us this framework, okay, where we have a cyclopentane ring with the carboxylic acid. So these two functional groups, they remain over here and the dimethyl group is over here. Now we have to add carboxylic acid. So in this entire ring, this carbon is free. Okay, so you cannot add anything over here. So only positions available are these two. Okay, so further, so camphoric acid, so they did a small chemical test where camphoric acid was heated to obtain camphoric anhydride. Camphoric anhydride upon bromination with bromine and CCl4. Okay, it gave them a monobromo camphoric anhydride. Usually, when you have a structure like this, if you do the bromination, okay, so it will be converted to RCBrCOOH and then it can be further brominated to give dibromo derivative. Okay, so this is what is it's a routine regular chemistry we observe. Okay, alpha methylene, this is an activated methylene, so bromines are protons are replaced by bromines. Okay, but here what is it that we are getting is a monobromo camphoric anhydride. What does it mean? It also further supports this one. Let's say if you have a carboxylic acid over here, you will have CH group over here, and here also the same. Okay, if you keep COOH over here, you will have CH over here, methane will be there. So that's the reason why what scientists confirmed is the structure of camphoric acid can be either this or this, okay, either one of these two. So if you draw it in a different format, so camphoric acid can be either this or this. The structure of camphoric acid was confirmed by synthesis and they ultimately found this as the camphoric acid structure. So now let's see the synthesis of camphoric acid. So camphoric acid was synthesized starting from dimethyl malonic acid and diethyl oxalate in the presence of strong alkali like sodium methoxide and ethanol. They got this compound. Okay, this is like a carboxylation of activated methylene group. And this intermediate, because we have double bond and double bond over here, we need to first add a methyl group over here. Okay, so alkylation was done with the help of alkali and methyl iodide. Because this is a symmetric molecule, alkylation, if it happens over here or here, it doesn't matter. So ultimately they got this compound. Now the ketones over here reduce to alcohols with the help of sodium amalgam and sodium hydroxide, this mixture. Now we have to remove these two oxygens. So it was dehydrated with the help of hydroiodic acid reagent to obtain this alkene. Now we have to hydrogenate. It was reduced, hydrogenated as well as hydrolyzed, or these two ester groups are hydrolyzed to ultimately obtain camphoric acid. So friends, this is the way how camphoric acid was synthesized. The physicochemical properties of camphoric acid were compared with the degradant product obtained from camphor. Oxidative degradation product obtained from camphor. Scientists found that both are identical. So in this way, camphoric acid structure was confirmed. But here, in case of camphoric acid, you will find two geometric isomers. Okay, so both COOH on one side and one COOH on one side. So this is trans camphoric acid. This is cis camphoric acid. So scientists were surprised to see both these derivatives are available in the natural mixture. Now we have to convert the camphoric acid to camphor. So camphoric acid is obtained upon degradation, oxidative degradation of camphor, means with the same carbon number. Okay, now we have to join these two carbons to obtain, because this is a single cycle, now we have to get a bicyclic compound. So these are the only two carbons available to join, and we have to add carbonyl carbon. Okay, so now we have to see whether carbonyl carbon can be over here or here. In both the cases, the degradant product will be this one. Now we have to see whether this is our camphor or this is our camphor. But camphor, when distilled with iodine, they got carvacrol. Okay, this is a known compound. Carvacrol is a known compound. Since we have an oxygen over here, they have taken this as the structure of camphor. And the structure of camphor was further verified with the synthesis. Synthesis of camphor was achieved in the beginning by Haller in 1908. So they started synthesizing camphor from camphoric acid. Okay, so this camphoric acid, what they have done, they have converted that one to anhydride by simply treating it with acetic anhydride and heating it. They got the anhydride. Now this anhydride was reduced with sodium amalgam to obtain a lactone. This camphor lactone was obtained. So this lactone was then treated with potassium cyanide to obtain nitrile. So this is the compound what they got. Now what they have done, they simply have gone for hydrolysis so that the carboxylic acid got converted to cyanide got converted to carboxylic acid, and then they made calcium salt of this compound, and upon heating they got the ketone. So here we have one rule, we call it as Blanc's rule. So here, according to Blanc's rule, so if the number of carbons that are forming a chain 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, okay, if the number of carbons that are making the dicarboxylic acid are more than 5, then if you make the corresponding calcium salt and heat it, you are going to get a ketone. If n is less than 5, less than or equal to 5, then you are going to get an anhydride. Okay, so here, for simple example, COOH, adipic acid, if you take and if you heat it, if you convert this one to calcium salt and if you heat it, what you are going to get is, you are going to lose one carbon, and you will get a cyclopentanone derivative. Whereas if you have COOH 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 COOH, then you are going to get an anhydride. Okay, you are going to get an anhydride without losing any carbons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, without losing any carbons, you are going to get an anhydride. So this is what we call it as Blanc's rule. So according to that, So in this case, how many carbons are there between this carboxylic acid and this carboxylic acid? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 carbons are there in this entire chain. So that's the reason why after converting it into calcium salt and after heating it, you are going to get a ketone. So friends, this is the way how camphor structure is elucidated. Structure is confirmed via synthesis. Right now, camphor is produced commercially via synthesis from alpha pinene. Okay, alpha pinene is obtained from turpentine oil. It's a lengthy procedure through carbocation mediated rearrangements. Several steps will be there, but ultimately camphor can be obtained commercially from pinene. So friends, I hope you understood the chemistry of camphor, and I thank all of you for your time and patient listening. If you have any doubts, please let me know through the comment section. Please share this information with your friends and subscribe to my YouTube channel to get more updates on the related topics. Thank you all. See you all again with another very interesting lecture soon. Thank you.